Amen. If you don't understand what I mean, you probably go to sleep. Okay? Am I not on?
Correct.
Oh, that's why I'm here.
Good morning!
Good morning!
What a terrible week, huh?
Yes.
You know, we've seen one of the things that people scream and cry out for is justice. And if you've had your head hit in the sand, you've found out that in our federal government there's no such thing as justice anymore. No. I don't care what your political stance is. Take politics out of it. Go at all. You know, there's none. And then I have to tell you, I was at Kmart, and one of the things you had to do as a manager was sometimes you went out and helped them stop shoplifters. And I went out one day and stopped a guy that showed me the film. He said, we're on the TV. He said, we're following this guy, Mr. Brown. We're kind of scared of him. And he put all kinds of tools. And so I went out and invested in him. He walked up and saw the tools and the sweats. I said, you need to come with me. And the gun went right in my face. He said, I don't think so. And I said, good luck with those tools. I was going to kind of quick on the feet. But I don't know what I'd have done if I had been. I don't know what I'd have done if I was a policeman. I don't know what I would do if I was out on the streets. And my job is to protect you. But my job is to go home to my children and my wife. And I'm sure sometimes it's not always good because it's a broken world and there's bad things out there and there's bad thoughts go through people's heads. And I'm sure bad decisions are made. I'm sure people, but I don't know what I would do. And then I watched a wonderful thing. I put it on Facebook that there was a minister, an African-American minister, protesting about the shot. About the shootings. And he was in Dallas. And he had his five-year-old boy because he wanted his son to grow up to understand what it's like for a black man in the United States of America. And all of a sudden the shots rang out. And he saw a white policeman laying down their lives for black people protesting. And he said, there is a problem. The problem is that we're not a Christian nation anymore. He said, we're focused on stupid stuff, and we need to focus on Jesus Christ. And if you get a chance, watch that video. It's like 8 minutes long. It's extremely powerful from a man who was there and experienced it from every angle. Because I'm telling you, you have no idea what it's like. You have no idea what it's like to be Hispanic. You have no idea what it's like to be Asian. So don't make judgments on that. Just love and pray. Because you don't know what it's like. Just like they don't know what it's like to be wrong. And we do know what it's like to be children of the living God. Amen?
Amen.
And if we bring that back, that's what everybody is. You know what? All of a sudden, there is no black, there is no white, there is no Hispanic, there is no Asian. Everybody are children of the living God. And everybody that's a child of the living God try to take care of each other. And that's what we teach in church, and that's what we're here for. And that's what we're invitational. See how that all comes together? Because the only thing that we're going to do to be able to make everybody realize they're children of the living God is to get them to hear about it. And when they get here, we have to tell the truth. Because I tell you, I've been preaching this for years, 20 years. The book of Revelation says, one of the ways that you will know that Jesus is coming soon is that there will be a great apostasy in the church. And people say, what is apostasy? And that's when churches are putting up banana-colored wallpapers. Apostasy means, I have to make sure you're awake every once in a while, folks. Apostasy means to walk away. It means that the church will walk away from Jesus Christ. Does everybody understand that? That the church, do you see the church walking away from Christ? You know, I was talking about business meeting the other night. Business meetings, how much time in churches' business meetings are time being focused on bringing people to Jesus Christ? How much discussion, how much are people after the desire to bring people to Jesus Christ? So, the Presbyterian Church had their national convention last week. And my sister, one of her three best friends, is a secretary in a large Presbyterian church. And she has trouble with their beliefs, so she attends a Southern Baptist church, but she gets their 8 a.m. service to keep her job. She's quitting her job this week because she went to their general meeting, the big national thing, and it started by a Muslim cleric coming up and praying that Allah would bless their meetings. That Allah would teach Christians that Muslims are their friends and to get along. I'm not doing a hate speech on Muslims. That's the Christian church. And if you do not know by this time that Allah and God are two different things, you haven't looked at your Bible. And you're not a follower of Christ. You've bought into something completely different. Because the Bible says that Jesus is the only way. Jesus says that he's the only way. God says that Jesus is the only way. And so if Allah says that Jesus is not who he says he is, don't you realize they're two different people? And if a major Christian denomination is asking Allah to bless them, do you not realize that there is a great apostasy happening? That the church is walking away from Jesus, and that means that anytime soon, people are going to start flying, folks. Jesus is going to take the church home. And the scary thing is you would save your friends from the walking dead. Does everybody know we got people in the United States of America who have spent money to prepare their houses for the zombie apocalypse? Right? And we're going to save our friends and neighbors from the zombies. And we're going to save our friends and neighbors from the evil Muslims or terrorists or Hillary Clinton or, I can't think of his first name, Trump. You know what I mean? We're going to do everything we can to save our neighbors from these people. But you know what? Are we concerned with saving people from being left behind? Are we concerned with seeing that people have a relationship with Christ? I was teasing Sam. We have been having the best time around our house. And it's also going to be part of our advertisement for the church now. How many people, and I want you to raise your hands honestly, are doing Pokemon Go? Oh, there's a new phone game app to get kids exercising. And what it is that it actually a GPS map comes up, and all the Pokemon in your neighborhood are out there. And if you see kids walking around with their phones, how many miles did you walk this weekend? 4 or 5 miles. That's good. You're really mad at me now. Anyway, if you see me and Sammy out walking last night, we caught a bee. What did we catch? Oh. But anyway, and one of the really cool things is, and this is what we're advertising, you get special awards when you stop at a church. Yeah, don't know who put the thing together, but love it, you know? And then last night, Kermit the Frog shows up on Facebook. And Kermit the Frog says, "It's amazing. Pokemon says go, and 30 million people are walking the streets. Jesus says go, and you're still sitting on the couch." And you know, it's the truth. The church has no desire for people to come to Christ anymore. And you can say, "Oh, pastor, that's not true." Really? What's the last time you talked to a friend about it? Have you ever invited somebody to church? I mean, seriously, went up and asked somebody to church? No, I mean somebody who goes to the Methodist church. Even a Mac guy. He's one of my best friends. So. Anyway, I'm talking about somebody that doesn't go to church. You ever look somebody that doesn't go to church in the eye and say, you need to come to my church this week? Because we see the numbers say that people don't. Have you ever invited somebody to give their life to Christ? You know, that cracks me up because I tell you, the first time I ever asked somebody to give my life to Christ, their life to Christ, I was 12 years old. This kid told me that his parents were beating him, and he didn't know what to do. And he didn't know who to go to, and he didn't know who to turn to. And I said, well, we'll do anything we can to help you. I said, the first thing you need to do, have you ever thought about praying to Jesus and asking him to come into your heart? I was 12. I remember it like anything. Right there in the street in New Carolina. And the thing of it is that I've been raised that that's what it was to do because I was raised in the Bible. I'd given my life to Christ when I was young. So I knew what it was meant to give up. And repeatedly through that, I talked to people about giving up. And the thing is, people say, well, you talk to people about giving your life to Christ and about giving their life to Christ because they're your minister. And I look at people and say, I became a full minister at the age of 37. 37 years old. I'd asked an awful lot of people to come to Christ before I was a minister. Because that's what it says to do. That's what it says to go out and do. I can't tell you the amount of people in the world over history who have brought people to Christ that were never ministers. But they were invitational. And people personally extend an invitation. And if you did it, how'd it go? Did it go well? Yeah, it went well. Even if they said no, it went well. Because you truly plant a seed. You know, people say all the time, I planted a seed. I planted a seed. That's wonderful. That's great. You want to plant a seed, ask somebody to give it off to Christ. You know that? There's a seed for you. They know you're serious then. You know? But you have to establish a relationship first. There's a lot of things that you have to do. But all of this stuff is invitational. And what's happening is now, the church is not invitational. We prefer to talk about the people we don't want to be around. And the size of the churches are shrinking. I had to tell the elders the other night. The American Baptist churches of the United States have these number of things that they do. There's large churches, medium churches, and small churches. And this week, to classify as a large church, they dropped the number to 105. 105 people is now classified as a large church. And you know what? It's because of society. It's because of the TV. It's because of that rock and roll. Because of that, I got drunk on plain country western stuff. You know what it is? It's because Christians don't invite people. We don't invite people. We're not inviting. We're not inviting to our church. We're not inviting to Jesus. And the thing is, Jesus wants you to invite everyone. He wants you to go out and let people know who you are. And be invitational and invite people. And before we go to God's Word, God, we come to you today. We just want to invite you. We want to know you. We don't want anybody left behind. We see that the world's going through all this. There is an answer. It's you. And we know that the Bible says in the life we use the excuse that times are going to get tough. But we don't know when you're coming back. But we do know one thing. We are not supposed to stop until the day you get here. And we're supposed to work and try to pray. Lord, we ask that you will fill us with your Holy Spirit today and help us to look into your word and see that we need to bring people to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First thing you have to realize is that we have to know what the lost is. And the lost is purely defined as people who don't know Christ. I'm going to tell you, they don't like to be called that. So don't go up and go, oh, I recognize that means that if the rapture happens, they're going to be left behind. They're not going to ever see the kingdom of heaven. They're done. And so we want to care about them. But you know, here's the thing about the lost. They only come when they are invited. The lost aren't sitting out there. They don't know they're lost. They don't want to know. Less and less people know anything about God. You know, it's really getting bad. And so when interviewed, here's the scary thing. Only 1 out of 4 lost people have ever been invited to church. Only 1 out of every 4 lost people in America today have ever been invited to church. Whose fault is that? Left that was able to give the screen stuff. Whose fault was that? It's the church. It's the church's fault. Not just First Baptist Sunbury. It's the church everywhere. The church hasn't been invited. We're really good at driving away. Aren't we? Aren't we really good at driving people away? We're really good at getting in people's faces and telling them how they're going to hell and all this stuff. But we are not good at inviting. We're not good at going out and caring about where our friends' souls are. And the scary thing is that we have to start inviting like crazy, because unless the church changes and becomes a more loving place, because that's their attitude, among those invited, only 1 out of 7 attend. Only 1 out of 7 people. So that means you have to continuously invite. But there's a couple myths that we need to talk about here. And the reason that people don't invite is the myth is the attitude of the unchurched towards the church. Okay? We don't invite people because they hate us. They don't like us. They don't want to be a part of it. They don't want anything to do with us. And so that keeps us from inviting them. And we believe that over and over, but in truth, the reality is, it's the attitude of the church towards the lost. It is. You know, you will run into people who are lost, and they will say, well, everybody at church thinks they're perfect. And I watch them, and they're hypocrites. And you know what? It's true. It's true. I see people now. You know, the thing is I want you to look at everybody around you today. And do you know what this is? This is sinners anonymous. You're the worst of the worst people. And you know you're so bad that you know you need Jesus. And that's why you're here. And that's why you come. Being here doesn't make anything special about you at all. It doesn't make anything great about you. It doesn't make you better than anybody. It doesn't make you holier than anybody. What it makes is it shows that you know you have a sin problem. And the only hope that you have for your sin problem is Jesus Christ. And that's why you meet together. That's why you love these people. And that's why you share the message. You know what's really so wonderful about AA? AA really wants to help other alcoholics. They'll do anything they can to reach out and try to be there for other people. You know, when you hear about people that are sponsors, you know, one of the things I've learned about AA, these sponsors work their tails off. Phone rings at 1:30 in the morning, they're there for somebody. Well, what if they have to work the next day? They are there for somebody. Because you know what? They want that person to live their dream. They want that person to be able to clean up their life and live a good, normal, healthy life. You know what? The church, we want somebody to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We'll meet at 1:30 in the morning, 2 in the morning. It doesn't matter if we have to get up to work the next day. It doesn't matter what we have to do. We will be there for somebody because we want them to have a good, healthy, productive life with a relationship with Jesus Christ. Because He is the only way. But see, it has to be in our hearts to invite. We have to desire to do that. We have to care about other people. We have to see people walking in the street. We have to see people walking in the mall. We have to see, you know, hundreds of angry people, you know. We have to see people with guns and hope that they bring their lives to Christ. And instead of going out today and talking about the Presbyterian Church and putting it down all day, shouldn't we be praying for them? And asking for revival from the Word of God in the church. And renewal of the Spirit in their hearts. Instead of condemning, instead of doing it, we have to have it in our hearts to see change for people. And when you want to look at the invitation, the greatest invitation that we've ever seen is in the fourth chapter of John. And I'm basically going to read the entire chapter, the fourth chapter of John, verses 1 through 42. You can read your own Bible, or you can look up on the screen, and we'll put all the scriptures up there for you. Jesus knew that the Pharisees had heard that he was winning and baptizing more followers than John was. But Jesus' disciples were really the ones doing the baptizing, not Jesus himself. Jesus left Judea and started for Galilee again, and this time he had to go through Samaria. And on his way, he came to the town of Sychar, and it was near the field that Jacob had long ago given to his son Joseph. The well that Jacob had dug was still there. Jesus sat down beside it because he was tired from traveling. It was noon, and after Jesus' disciples had gone into town to buy some food, the Samaritan woman came to draw water from the well. Jesus asked her, "Would you please give me a drink of water?" "You are a Jew," she replied, "and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink of water when Jews and Samaritans won't have anything to do with each other?" Jesus answered, "You don't know what God wants you to give you, and you don't know who is asking you for a drink. If you did, you would ask me for water that gives life." "Sir," the woman said, "you don't even have a bucket, and the well is deep. Where are you going to get this life-giving water? Our ancestor Jacob dug this well for us, and his family and animals got water from it. Are you greater than Jacob?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will get thirsty again. But no one who drinks the water I give will ever be thirsty again. The water I give is like a flowing fountain that gives eternal life." The woman replied, "Sir, please give me a drink of that water. Then I won't get thirsty and have to come to this well again." Jesus told her, "Go and bring your husband." The woman answered, "I don't have a husband." "That's right," Jesus replied, "you're telling the truth. You don't have a husband. You've already been married 5 times, and the man you're now living with isn't your husband." The woman said, "Sir, I can see that you're a prophet. My ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews say Jerusalem is the only place to worship." Jesus said to her, "Believe me, the time is coming when you won't worship the Father either on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans don't really know the one you worship, but we Jews do know the God we worship, and by using us, God will save the world. But time is coming and is already here. Even now, the true worshipers are being led by the Spirit to worship the Father according to the truth. These are the ones the Father is seeking to worship him. God is Spirit, and those who worship God must be led by the Spirit to worship him according to the truth." The woman said, "I know the Messiah will come. He is the one we call Christ. When he comes, we will explain everything to us." "I am that one," Jesus told her, "and I'm speaking to you now." The disciples returned by this time, and we were surprised to find Jesus walking with a woman. But none of them asked him what he wanted or why he was talking with her. The woman left her water jar and ran back into town. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I've ever done. Could he be the Messiah?" Everyone in town went out to see Jesus. While this was happening, Jesus' disciples were saying to him, "Teacher, please eat something." But Jesus told them, "I have food that you know nothing about." His disciples started asking each other, "Has someone brought him something to eat?" Jesus said, "My food is to do what God wants. He is the one who sent me. I must finish the work that he gave me to do. You may say that there are still 4 months until the harvest time, but I tell you, look, and you will see that the fields are ripe and ready to harvest. Even now, the harvest workers are receiving their reward by gathering a harvest that brings eternal life. Then everyone who plants the seeds and everyone who harvests the crop will celebrate together. So the saying proves true. Some plant the seed and others harvest the crop. I'm sending you to harvest crops in the fields where others have done all the hard work." A lot of Samaritans in that town put their faith in Jesus because the woman had said, "This man told me everything I'd ever done." They came and asked him to stay in the town, and he stayed on for 2 days. Many more Samaritans put their faith in Jesus because of what they heard him say. They told the woman, we no longer have faith in Jesus just because of what he told us. We have heard him ourselves, and we are certain that he is the Savior
of the world.
So Jesus goes to this historical monument, the Well of Jacob. And he's there with Samaritans who, you can see a big racial difference here in the fact that the Jews hate the Samaritans. They don't like them. They consider them enemy. They consider them lower than themselves. They don't consider them equal. And so Jesus walks up, and he not only walks up to a Samaritan, who you should have nothing to do with, but it's a woman. And at this point in time, guys didn't go up and talk to women. Does everybody understand that? It just didn't happen. As a matter of fact, we still see that in the world. It's a little bit of a Muslim thing that we don't understand what the verb is. If you are in those countries, you don't just go up and talk to a woman. It doesn't happen. And it didn't at this time. Jesus went up. But we want to look today at some steps of an invitation. The first thing that Jesus did was he asked for a drink. And the reason he asked for a drink is he started a conversation. He started a conversation. This is one of the things I see Christians do. They don't talk to people. I get annoying to a lot of people. When I leave a restaurant, I'm best friends with the waitress. When I get done at checkouts, I know everything about the checkout operator. Okay? I just meet and talk to everybody. And you know, it annoys my children. I love them. Sammy's a lot like me. But the thing is that a lot of them say, I forget what they used to tell me, but they didn't. They just kept talking and talking and talking. Going on. Gab. Are you going to gab at? Okay. Yeah, we got to go. And so anyway, I've always done that. But you know, the thing of it is that the people that you do it with, they like it. Because nobody does it. Ever since it's a hurry. Nobody wants to stop and talk. Nobody wants to have any conversation. And like the guy on the couch, you're not going up to the registered program and say, you need Jesus, have a great day! Not going to happen. See, in order to bring people to Christ, you're going to have relationships. And it's amazing because in the small groups, Bibles that you can find, there are even these things on the side pages called icebreakers. How to get people talking. How to get people to open up. And finding these friendships. You have to have icebreakers. You have to look for a purpose, a way to get to know somebody, to talk to them about Jesus. You're not just going to be able to, you know, go up and throw flyers at the guy. Not going to work. There has to be a relationship. And when you start with the conversation, the second thing is establishing that personal relationship. Notice that Jesus showed concern in her life. You know? He talked to her about her life. And we can talk to people about life, but we do not have to make a stand. We do not have to stop and back off of issues because people accuse us of things. You know, I have a lot of gay friends. A lot of gay people that I know in the communities that I consider friends, and you know why? They all know that I don't believe in homosexuality. Do you know that I know people that are cheating on the taxes? Do you know that I know people who are fooling around in their lives? And I can't tell you how many people I know who are having I know a lot of people that are sinning. I know people who are just flat out mean. You know that? I'm going to tell you. They sure don't like gay people because they're sinners, but it's okay to be mean. And nasty. And unloving. And the thing of it is that we can stand up and say, I don't believe about that. It's their job to try for a relationship. I'm not going to try for a relationship. I'm not going to sit here and preach out of that. I'm going to tell them they need Jesus. And then as they learn and know about Jesus, Jesus tells them what's wrong and what's right. My job is to teach them about Jesus. And in doing that, I have to show concern for their life. Concern for eternity. And then the third thing is, Jesus told him who he was. He told her who he was. He told her he was the living one. He told her.